Incident at Raven's Gate is a 1988 Australian sci-fi directed by Rolf de Heer.
Well, the film starts, well, over the credits of the film's beginning, you get a, it's not really a narration, but you hear two voices and they're talking about a UFO crash that has happened somewhere out in the Australian outback. And in fact, one of the voices, I think they've been like 72 hours late in reporting it, and the other voice is saying, well, you better get your arse into gear, go out and investigate this. And then from there you're led to a homestead out in the outback that's clearly had something's gone wrong. Everything's on fire, and there's a policeman inside one of the houses, and he's, you know, searching around for answers. He's got his torch out, his gun out, it's all dark, and it's kind of weird noises going on in the background and strange things. And then suddenly this guy, one of the voices you hear at the beginning, crashes through the window to kind of make himself known. And he's kind of described him as an astrophysicist, but he's kind of like a man in black, isn't he?
Yeah, kind of, yeah.
A little bit. Weird. Trying to keep things a bit secret.
Yeah.
And so he kind of partners up with the policeman. And then essentially the rest of the film is told in flashback. So you're taken back to before the incident, during the incident, and then the aftermath of the incident. And that involves, three main protagonists. You've got the guy that runs the farm, Richard. The film's not really about an alien crash.
No.
It's more about, like I said, what goes on in when these people find themselves involved in this incident. It's also about water. So Richard, the farmer, he's kind of using water to, well, as he says, to sustain the future for his family. So it maybe feels slightly ahead of its time. I mean, obviously, Australia is famous for not having enough water. I think Perth has been in a constant drought for the last 30 years or something. So it's something the Australians have a problem with. And then during this incident, lots of his animals die and his water dries up. And then his brother is there currently working for him because he's on parole. He's been released from jail for stealing a police car. So his brother's a bit more rebellious, and he's there to work off his parole. And then you've got Richard's wife, Rachel, and she clearly loves her husband, but she's an artist, and she clearly pines for being back in the city.
Yeah, she's a bit bored of country
life. But also has a bit of a thing for the brother as well. Possibly, I mean, it's kind of suggests that she was like him in her earlier life, and she maybe sees, you know, a bit more rebellious nature in him. And then, of course, things happen. Strange things, birds drop from the sky, and animals die, and weird lights appear.
And there's another farmhouse where something strange
there's
happens.
There's another farmhouse where things, very strange things happen. And there's lots of other characters that come in. I mean, the film essentially is this encounter that happens, and then what then happens to the people around it. And it's odd.
Yep.
I mean, like you said, it's directed by Rolf de Heer. Obviously, he went on to become, well, I mean, he's well known in Australia, and he's mostly known for Bad Boy Bobby, which is quite a revolting but really great movie that he did a couple of years later. He also did Ten Canoes, which is an excellent film, which I think was completely in the Aboriginal language. That's a great movie. So he's done lots of they're kind of art house cinema, Rolf de Heer makes, but, you know, they're always quite interesting. But this one is odd. I think it's got some really great stuff in there. One scene I really liked, actually, is when Eddie, the punkish brother, he goes into town and he's racing through the countryside playing like punk music in his car. And then he passes his policeman, who's a bit of an opera-loving policeman, and he's got opera blaring out of his car. And then this encounter happens, this weird UFO incident, and the music swaps between the cars, which I thought was... I just thought that was great. It was just quite a random moment. You had slight issue with the opera-loving policeman.
Well, yeah, he kind of has a subplot where there's a barmaid at the pub that the brother goes to after this event, and they're having a bit of a relationship, but the cop is kind of obsessed with her and keeps asking her out, and he's also looking for an excuse to put this brother back in prison, I think, and he kind of says, you know, if you go out with me, I'll go easy on him and things like that. But it kind of never goes anywhere. It does go somewhere, but not really. It doesn't really serve any purpose as far as the overall plot goes. It doesn't. It's all a bit pointless. There's a whole subplot which just has really nothing to do with anything else, which is just pointless. So, you know, apart from that, you know, it was, I was all on board with all the sci-fi stuff and the weird stuff, and, you know, the sort of close encounters kind of kind of stuff. But the that whole subplot, if I want to have a subplot, but at least have it relate to the main plot in some way, rather than just completely abandoning the main plot and just having some random things happen that don't have anything to do with anything else. It's difficult to talk about it, not giving anything away.
No, exactly.
But,
yeah. No, I thought that was an interesting point, because I didn't... I kind of just went with it anyway.
Well, because I was waiting for it to go somewhere.
Sure.
And for the brother to maybe get in trouble somehow and have to, you know, help him get out of trouble, but that doesn't happen.
Yeah, I mean, it's... I think, I mean, obviously, Rolf de Heer, this was his third film. So, second film? So he was, you know, some directors, they get a big hit with their first film and they're very lucky. Other filmmakers kind of have to hone their craft a bit. And I think this is clearly a filmmaker honing his craft. It's not perfect, but it's some really nice shots, I think. You know, obviously there's lovely, you know, kind of shots of the Australian outback, and there's some quite interesting moments in there. One of the moments was a little bit of The Thing, like when they go into one of the houses and they find a couple of bodies, bit like The Thing.
Mm.
The scene after that I thought was quite cool and kind of ramps up the action a little bit.
I thought it was going to be kind of... Bad Taste, like, because it had a similar vibe, you know, look wise it looked a bit like Bad Taste. It had a few sort of similar camera moves and things that made me think of Bad Taste, but it doesn't. Bad Taste, obviously, a lot more tongue in cheek. This takes itself a bit more seriously.
It takes itself a bit more seriously, yeah. Although still, it has got that kind of, I call it Aussie humour. Yeah. I mean, is that
there is a guy called Bruce.
There is, that's true. So. But there's kind of, I think it's, I don't know whether it's playful. I mean, yes, I think it does take itself seriously, but I think there is a kind of playfulness about Australian. I mean, I don't know if this was listed as an Ausploitation movie, but it's kind of, it's like an art house Ausploitation movie.
I mean, I'd say even something like Wolf Creek, which is, you know, is pretty hard going for some of it. Yeah. You know,
it's got that humour.
It has,
dark humour to it, yeah.
You want to hate. Funny. Mick Taylor, but you also kind of love him as well, because he's so funny.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not going to rattle off all the people in this film. There's quite a few actors. Not many of them have gone on to do much else. But there's two notable people in this film. There's the actor Terry Camilleri, who plays the kind of the man in black in the film. You know him because he played Napoleon in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, which is like either a year before or the year after.
A couple of years after.
And then there's also Vincent Gil, and he plays the... the opera-loving policeman in this, and of course you'll know him because he played Knight Rider in the original Mad Max film. And then, yes, there are obviously other actors in the film, but I think if you live outside Australia, you possibly won't know them. No. They haven't cropped up in anything that I know of. It was actually renamed Encounter at Ravensgate, I think for the American market, possibly going on the back of something like Close Encounters. Mm. I mean, it is an encounter film. Yeah. In fact, there are scenes, obviously the famous scene in Close Encounters with the, you know, when he's in the truck is a little bit like the scene in this when the you know, they're in there and the radio music swaps.
There's lots of bright lights coming through doorways and windows and that.
Yeah, that's in there too. That's, yeah, definitely. So, I mean, it is an encounter film. Obviously, it's not an alien, it's not like an alien invasion film or anything like that. So I can understand why they'd rename it to Encounter. I prefer the word incident. I think that's makes it a bit more... You know, not sure exactly what's going on. But either of the titles, I think, work perfectly well for this film. You can actually see it at the moment. You can see it because Amazon Prime have got it.
Yep.
So if you're a member of Amazon Prime, then, you know, you can watch it on there for free. And I recommend... if you like kind of strange, surreal sci-fi films, I think Australia did quite a lot of interesting sci-fi films in the 80s and 90s. So if you like that kind of thing, then I think this is probably up your street. Are there DVDs available of it?
I think there was an Australian DVD. It doesn't seem to be particularly easy to get hold of. It was released on Blu-ray in the States, along with two other films on the same disc. Slipstream, which stars Mark Hamill and Bill Paxton. And what was it on? Creature. Starring Klaus Kinski. Apparently, you know, it's... Yeah. That's relatively easy to pick up, I think, but it depends whether you want the other two films as well. And the quality apparently isn't great. I mean, the version on Amazon, covered in scratches, and you've got the cigarette burn marks up in the corner. And
which actually make it quite cool. It kind of gives it a grindhouse.
It does give it a grindhouse charm, yeah. But it's not in a good state, to be honest, that version. But probably no one's ever going to do anything to clean it up, I wouldn't have thought. So it is what it is.
So that was Incident at Ravenscape. And if you like this video, well, give us a comment. We'd love to hear from you. Have a chat about, you know, if you've seen it or if you haven't seen it, or you want to go and check it out because you can, because it's free. Or follow us on Facebook or Twitter. And
yeah, subscribe, like the video, watch some of our other videos that will be coming up after this one. Yep.
So we will catch you next time for the next one.
See you later.